Hallelujah. And thank you so much, Ben and Levi. Man, that was good. That was good, man. Thank you guys so much. And if you're thankful for God's amazing grace, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. We are so thankful. And our children are being dismissed to children's church. And we're going to try to get our children's ministry started up again. And anyway, good to see such a good crowd here this morning. Praise the Lord. I'm glad you guys are here, and I hope God is working in your life every day, and you're kind of coming here. This is kind of the gym. You're working out a little bit, but then also continue your workout throughout the week, right? And commune with God, read God's word, pray, and just trust Him and look to Him for wisdom and understanding. We've been going through a series called Galatians Grounded in Grace. And part 7 is the zeal deal, finding and directing your zeal. And the thing is, what should be our passion? Before I recommitted my life to God and God got a hold of me, my passion was acting. It was in the arts. It was in theater. And that was my passion. It drove me. I tried to study with the best people in the world. Lee Strasberg, who, you know, taught Marlon Brando and Marilyn Monroe and others, a lot of other famous people. Some of you older folks remember them, okay? Some people today, you say Henry Fonda, and they're like, who's Henry Fonda, you know? But I studied with them. That was my passion. And then the Lord got a hold of my life, and my passion was to follow Him. And each of you have your own story. Before the Lord got a hold of your life and you really were committed to discipleship, you had many things, many interests in the world that drew you different directions. But when the Lord gets a hold of your life, you're called to be a disciple, to be a Christ follower, and He takes precedence over everything else. There are a lot of things in life that I do enjoy, but ultimately I go back to the Lord and say, Lord, is this what I should be doing? I mean, I want my passion, my utmost passion, and my zeal to be directed towards You. And so when we are in that relationship, a right relationship with God, I think zeal will just come. Our fervor will come. I mean, there will be an excitement within us that doesn't have to be forced, that doesn't have to be fabricated, that you don't have to like, I'm going to psych myself up. I laugh because when I was in seminary, there was this music student, okay? And, seminary got pretty tough sometimes, studying for all those tests and reading and... We'd ask him how he's doing. We'd say, how are you doing? And he's going, I feel great. I feel fine. I feel like this all the time. I feel great. I feel fine. I feel like this all the time. And we would crack up, you know. We're like, yeah, this robot of zeal. But he would crack us up. And we're like, yeah, we get it. But life can be very difficult. But our zeal is in God. Our passion is in Him. And so I'm not going to review the first 5. We may be going back at the very end. But when I came to Galatians 4:18, Paul was saying, okay, the Judaizers who was trying to get Christians to go back under the law plus Jesus plus the law, he said, no, don't do that. They are zealously courting you so that you can be zealous for them. He said, you don't need to be zealous for them. You need to be zealous towards the gospel, the true gospel, that when you trust in Jesus, you need nothing else. Jesus. And putting faith in Jesus is salvation. You don't have to work. But because you are saved, we want to work for the Lord Jesus Christ. So Galatians 4:18 simply says this. But it is good to be zealous in a good thing always, and not only when I am present with you. So he said, it's good to be zealous, but don't be zealous for the wrong things. Be zealous in the things of the kingdom of God. Be zealous for those things that will build up the church, will build up your family, will build up others around you, because we all need encouragement. We all need encouragement. Keep going. Don't stop. Keep believing. Have faith. Why did this happen? I don't know, but God knows it happened, and God's in control, and God can help you get through this. Now, I was going to show you a video last time about fervent prayer, but it's going to tie into the first point that we look at this morning, which is number 6, and we're not going to look at that right now, but we're going to go to it in just a minute. But watch this prayer scene from War Room.
You've done it again, Lord. You've done it again. You are good and you are mighty and you are merciful. And you keep taking care of me when I don't deserve it. Praise you, Jesus. You are Lord. Give me another one, Lord. Guide me to who you want me to help. Raise up more that will call upon your name. Raise up those that love you and seek you and trust you. Raise them up, Lord. Raise them up. Lord, we need a generation of believers who are not ashamed of the gospel. We need an army of believers, Lord, that hate to be lukewarm and will stand on your word above all else. Raise them up, Lord. Raise them up. I pray for unity among those that love you. I pray that you open their eyes so that they can see your truth, Lord. I pray for your hand of protection and guidance. Raise up a generation, Lord, that will take light into this world, that will not compromise when under pressure, that will not cower, Lord, when others fall away. Raise them up, Lord, that they will proclaim that there is salvation in the name of Jesus Christ. Raise up warriors, Lord, who will fight on their knees, who will worship you with their whole hearts, Lord. Lord, call us to battle that we may proclaim you King of kings and Lord of lords. I pray these things with all my heart. Raise them up, Lord. Raise them up.
Amen. Woo. That is fervent prayer. That is fervent prayer. That is boldly coming to the throne of grace and asking God to help, asking God to raise up people. And that is the very first point that we have here. Now, she was fervent in prayer, but what was she fervent about? She was fervent about the salvation and the spiritual progress and the integrity of God's people. And so we're coming into an era in the world, not just in the United States of America, but in the world where we have to stand for the word of God. I didn't write it, you didn't write it, but God wrote it. And the word of God is a lamp into our feet and is a light into our path and a lamp into our feet and a light into our path. And so we need to stand up on that word of God and walk in that light because it is truth. And Jesus said, heaven and earth will pass away, but my word by no means will pass away. Okay? It's just not going to happen. And so the spiritual progress of God's people. In Colossians 4, 12 through 13, Epaphras, who is one of you, a bondservant of Christ, greets you, always laboring fervently, like this woman, fervently for you in prayers that you may stand perfect. That means complete. Perfect and complete in all the will of God. Maturity, that's what he's praying for, that you may be mature. For I bear him witness that he has a great zeal for you and those who are in Laodicea and those in Hierapolis. And so Epaphras, he was laboring for them that they would be mature Christians, that they would be growing Christians, because we're not just only to be believers, but disciples who love the Lord with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Amen? And that's who we're to be. Also in Colossians 1, 9 through 11, it says, for this reason we also, since the day we heard it, Paul's talking about him and those that labor with him, do not cease to pray for you, to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom. Wisdom is the application of knowledge and spiritual understanding. Why? saying, I want spiritual understanding as to why the Lord wants me to do this or do that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him. Notice that, fully pleasing him, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. Wow. Strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, for all patience and long suffering with joy. You know, sometimes we have to be a lot of times patient and long suffering. But he said, when you do that, I want you to still have the joy. When you have to endure what you don't want to endure, when you have to be patient and put up with circumstances that are not favorable or people that are trying, I want you to do so with joy. And so that is the maturity of believers. We need to be fervent for the spiritual progress of God's people, of you, for one another. Iron sharpening iron. Also, we need to be, number seven, we need to be fervent for the salvation of others. I think this is so self-evident that I really don't even have to explain this very much, but it is our desire to see people saved. That is the work of the kingdom of God. That is the Great Commission, to reach out to others, to see them saved. Paul wanted to see people saved so much that when he was witnessing before Festus and King Agrippa, they thought he was mad. In fact, in Acts 26, 24 through 29, now as he, meaning Paul, thus made his defense, Festus said with a loud voice, Paul, you are beside yourself. Much learning is driving you mad. But he said, I am not mad. I'm not crazy, most noble Festus, but speak the words of truth and reason, for the king, before whom I also speak freely, knows these things, for I am convinced that none of these things escapes his attention, since this thing was not done in a corner. King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? I know that you do believe. Then Agrippa said to Paul, you almost persuade me to become a Christian. Ugh, that's hard to take. It's just go ahead, believe. And Paul said, I would to God that not only you, but also all who hear me today, because there were probably other people around, might become both almost and altogether such as I am, except for these chains, because he was a prisoner at that time. 1 Timothy 2, 3 through 4 says this, for this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. So many people don't know the knowledge of the truth, which is Jesus, the spiritual reality of all things, which is the gospel. And so that should tug at our hearts. That should just drive us to tell people the truth. And you can't convince them. You can tell the truth to them and let the Lord and the Holy Spirit deal with their hearts. Because it's frustrating sometimes when you talk to people about the Lord and they say, no, I don't want to do that, or I'm not interested. But you know what? That's not your job to save them. That's the Lord's job. You share with them the gospel. You share with them your testimony. And you know what? God can bring that back in their minds and in their hearts. And at a moment that of God's choosing, he will lead them to himself. I wrote this about evangelism. And then I'm going to go on to the next one. But and it's kind of this long, lengthy paragraph. Not too long, but this is what I wrote. Evangelism is proclaiming to those who are lost, spiritually dead, unforgiven, living in darkness, captivated by sin and Satan, under God's judgment, and headed to an eternal hell, that God, their Creator, loves them. And by heeding the gospel, they can become completely forgiven, saved, born again by the Holy Spirit, spiritually alive, freed from Satan, freed from all condemnation, illuminated by the truth of God, and become heaven-bound children of God by trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ, the only Savior of the world. Amen? That's what evangelism is. It's taking them out of the power of darkness, of Satan, into the light of God and the power of God, and being children of promise again. So that's what it's about. I was reading about some athlete or some star the other day, and somebody, you know, he said, I don't like to talk about heaven and hell. It's too binary. I was like, what? What does that mean? It's like, well, I'd like something more of a middle option. You know, it like, listen, There's two eternal destinations, not on my authority, but on the authority of God's word. There's a heaven and a hell. Okay. And so, you know, some of you are explaining binary to one another, I think. But anyway, that's what the Bible says. And we're in this day and age that people don't want to really hear the truth. And you know what? The gospel is offensive to those who are lost. It's saying you are a sinner. You cannot save yourself. You are under judgment. And they're going, oh, how dare you? Listen, I'm trying to help you. I say this because I love you, not to condemn you. Okay? But I'm trying to help you to know the truth of God. Why did Jesus die on the cross? Why did he die on the cross? There was a reason. If he didn't have to die on the cross, he wouldn't have died on the cross. He said, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. The cup of the cross. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. That's what he said. It was necessary. A long time ago, there was this book. Some of you old timers remember it. I'm okay, you're okay. Remember that? We're not okay. I'm not okay without Jesus. You're not okay without Jesus. All right. Anyway, we need to have a heart for saving people, to seeing people come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Number eight, your spiritual ardor. I pulled up an old word we don't use very much, ardor. But that word ardor, it means emotional warmth, passion, eagerness, enthusiasm, and intense heat or fire. It comes, I believe, from a Latin word meaning fire. And so we need to stir up our spirits. We, you know, some of you that have been camping, I know Hal's camp, some others have camped out. And, you know, sometimes the campfire is kind of cold and you have to stir the fire a little bit. And when you stir it a little bit, the flames pop up again. Okay, because it's died out. You see the embers, but when you stir it up, the fire comes. And sometimes we have to ask, Lord, I'm kind of, you know, I'm not there, Lord. You need to stir me up. You need to stir me up. Just stir me up. And God, restore to me the joy of my salvation, right? Well, sometimes we need to say, Lord, just restore to me the joy of my salvation because I've lost that joy. And when we become fervent and zealous for him, we recover that joy. We recover that joy. Your spiritual ardor. Romans 12:11 says, not lagging in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Ephesians 5:18 tells us this. And do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. You get filled with the Spirit, you will be zealous. To the church at Laodicea in Revelation 3. I know your works, that you're neither cold nor hot. I could wish you were cold or hot. This is Jesus speaking. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. Spew sounds better, but that's really what it means. And then verse 19 says, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore, be zealous and repent. Repent of just going through the motions. Repent of just being indifferent. Repent of your apathy. Repent of your compromise. You know, when you compromise the things of God, it's like pouring cold water on a fire. It's just going to put it out. We know that David, when he brought the Ark of the Covenant back to Jerusalem, what was David doing? He was dancing before the Lord. Man, you know, he had a heart for the Lord. And we know Michael, Saul's daughter, his wife, despised him. She's like, oh, he's being ridiculous. Listen, David didn't care how he looked dancing in his ephod. He was caring what the Lord thought of him. And he was looking to the Lord and he was zealous for the things of God. And so a lot of times we can't like, well, what are other people going to think about me? You can't get lost in that. That's a losing game to have the fear of men. You need to be who God created you to be, on task for him. One of the ways we can keep our zeal is being purified daily, asking the Lord to cleanse you of your sins and having a heavenly perspective. You are citizens of heaven and you are sojourners on this earth. We need to keep that heavenly Christian worldview. We're here, yes, but our real home is in heaven. And we have to not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind through prayer, through the word of God. through those things, through fellowshipping with one another. That's why we're here, to stir one another up. And so we need to have that by laying up our treasure in heaven also. The Lord said, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. And by living under the influence of the Holy Spirit, being influenced, saying, Lord, lead me by your Spirit. Lead me by your Holy Spirit, not by what I want and not by the whims of the world and whatever the culture deems as acceptable, yada, yada, yada. I want to be led by your Holy Spirit. And a lot of times that means you will be countercultural. Okay. What is popular is not always right. And what is right is not always popular, right? Also, we should be zealous for good works. Good works. And I thought, well, what are good works? I wrote down this short little definition. Acts of loving service that are birthed by your relationship with Jesus Christ. The reason you do things for other people is because of Jesus Christ and your relationship with him. And you want to bless them. You want to help these other people. And Titus 2:14 says, he gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. So when we have opportunity, we need to take advantage of that opportunity, right? Because, you know, as we get older, our opportunities lessen and lessen and lessen. And so we need to take advantage of our opportunities, right? Galatians 6:9 says, and let us not grow weary while doing good. Because sometimes we do. Sometimes we get burned out. For in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Sometimes we just have to go to the Lord and say, Lord, I just need you to help me. I'm getting weary. I'm getting weighed down. I'm getting, you know, focused on other things that are just being a burden to me. And we have to ask him again to take those burdens from us and help us to continue to fight the good fight of faith. That's what the Bible says. Hebrews 10:24-25. The reason we're here this morning. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. We're stirring up love and good works this morning, y'all. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. Don't, even though this isn't good language, don't stop going to church, okay? Don't do that. As is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. So continue to assemble together. Continue to go to church. Continue to provoke one another. Stir up love and good works among yourself. And so we need to realize, again, the need. There's so many people in this world that are doing bad things. I just get sick of listening to the evening news about stealings and stabbings and shootings and people ripping each other off and phone scams. You know, like, hi, I'm calling from the Social Security Department. We just want to verify your Social Security number. I had somebody the other day said, I screamed in the phone, you scammers, blah, blah, blah. You know, anyway. You just kind of want to reach through the little phone and grab their little necks and jerk them back, you know. I mean, really, that's what they do. They go to work to scam innocent, good-hearted people out of their money. Ugh, it's pathetic. Yeah, God, judge them this day. If they're calling on this Sunday, God, deal with them in Jesus' name. Really. If you're going to do it, I don't know. Don't do it on a Sunday, all right? Realize this also. When we're talking about good works, you are better suited for some task than anyone else in the world. There are some tasks that God has for you that you're better suited for than anyone else in the world. That's part of your good works. Maybe, you know, as a grandparent, as a parent, who can better shape a child's life better than a parent? Or I know many of you had wonderful grandparents. I love my grandparents. I know that they shaped my life. My grandma took us to church every time we visited. She didn't say, oh, we got, you know, house full of company. She brought us all to church, all right? It was really tough. There was one bathroom in that house and about 20 people. And we're like, are you done yet? We need to get in there. We got to leave in 10 minutes. And like, you know. Some child would be in there and like we'd have to bust in, you know, anyway. There's six adults out here waiting to get ready, you know, to brush your teeth or whatever they need to do. And so my grandma, there are some things in this world you're gifted at that you are better suited for than anyone else in the world. Just think of that. And you know, when Jesus called the 12 disciples, he had a specific will for each one of their lives. James and John, Matthew, you don't need to be a tax collector anymore. I want you to follow me. Andrew and Peter, you're going to preach the message at Pentecost when the Holy Spirit falls on that in that upper room. After that, you're going to preach that message. And so I want you to know there are some good works, some works of the kingdom that God has for you to do that you are better suited for. You have better relationships with that person that God wants to reach than anyone else in the world. Just file that away. And then finally, we need to be zealous for the Word of God. Zealous for the Word of God. And I have quite a few scriptures. I'm going to try to go through these quickly. But the Word of God is so important. We are sanctified by the Word of God. We are sanctified by the Word of God. When we heed the Word of God, it's truth. It's truth. And so, Jeremiah the prophet, we call him the weeping prophet, he said, "Then I said, I will not make mention of him nor speak any more in his name." Jeremiah just got tired of talking to people that weren't listening. But his word was in my heart. This prophetic word was in my heart like a burning fire shut up in my bones. I was weary of holding it back and I could not. He said, "Even though you don't want to hear it, I am going to tell you and share the word of God with you again. Because the Bible says the word of God is alive and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword." The word of God is alive and powerful because it represents the living God. You know, it represents him and it speaks of his will. The word of God, we're not just to know it, but we're to do it and obey it. And so he said, "I had a message from God and I had to share it. I had to share it with this rebellious people, even though I was pretty fed up in doing so, because they would not listen." So we need to know that we need to be zealous for the word of God because it's alive, because it burns in our hearts. Number two, Revelation 22, 18 through 19, we must be zealous for the integrity of the word of God. "For I testify to everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book, if anyone adds to these things, God will add to him the plagues that are written in this book. And if anyone takes away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part from the book of life, from the holy city, from the things which are written in this book." Very serious. I don't think it just applied to Revelation. And I don't think a true Christian would ever alter the word of God. Not a true Christian. So if you alter the word of God for your benefit, which a lot of cults have done, listen, there's some very serious warnings here in this passage. So we are not to alter the word of God. We must fight for the integrity of the word of God. Also, it is profitable. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable." I like things that are profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. You know, there's a whole sermon here. There's a whole sermon. But it is profitable that we know true doctrine. And that means, you know, the underpinnings of scripture. What it says about salvation and what it says about the character of God and the condition of fallen man and the future and the past and et cetera, et cetera. For reproof and correction, because some people stray. And for instruction in righteousness, how can I be holy? How can I be fully pleasing to God? Look in the Word of God. Also, it produces faith. If Romans 10:17 simply says, "So then faith comes by hearing or perceiving, and perceiving by the Word of God." So if my wife says, "I'm going to call you in a little bit," I have faith that she's going to call me because of her word. She said, "I'll call you in a little bit." Okay. And so I have faith. And so when we read God's promises, I have faith because God has said it in his word. Matthew 4 also. And this is, it is the, it is sustenance. I've got a definition for this, but let me read this scripture first. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. That's why we should be zealous, because it is life. God's word provides the essential spiritual sustenance for the eternal well-being of every human being. That's what it does. It has God's word has the essential spiritual sustenance for the eternal well-being of every human being. And by feeding on God's word, you will know the life that God wants you to live. You will actually have a good life. You will have a life that's filled with the things of God, the goodness of God, the fruits of God. There's so many bad things in this world, so much darkness out there. I can't even believe it. You can't even believe it sometimes. I read about these horror stories. Oh, that they would know God and the goodness of God. Hallelujah. Amen. Okay, Ephesians 6:17 says we can make war with the word of God and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Okay, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And so when Jesus was tempted, he used the word of God against Satan, and he came against him with the word of God. It is written. It is written. It is written, Satan. Basically, shut your mouth and listen. And this is what God has said, Satan. This is what, because Satan will try to get you to doubt the word of God. Satan will try to get you, you know what Satan will sometimes try to do? Your life's not worth living. You just might as well take your life. He'll say that. I've had people say, you know, I've even just thought of that. And I said, man, that is a lie from the pit of hell. Don't you do that. Oh, that would be the worst thing possible. He tries to discourage you. He tries to confuse you. You stand upon the rock solid word of God. In fact, speaking of rock solid, Matthew 24:27, Jesus said this. And when the sayings in the Greek, that's the logos. It's really in the New American Standard. It says the word of God is what it says. The words of mine. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings or words of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the rains descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell. It collapsed, and great was its fall. Listen, we have to stand upon the rock of the Lord Jesus Christ. I was reading one of those survival magazines the other day, and it's like, what to do if you ever step into quicksand, you know? It said, first of all, when going through quicksand country, be sure to have a stout pole. I mean, who does that? But I know what quicksand. Some of you might not have, because I used to watch a lot of old Tarzan movies. And people like the last thing in their hand, like, there they go, you know. Hopefully it was at the end of the show, it was the bad guy, you know, like, yeah. But I know that there were times around the river. We lived on the North Fork of the Red River down in southwestern Oklahoma. And we had cattle that would get in the quicksand, and they could not get out. And you had to get a rope around their neck, around their horns, and get a horse and try to get them out. Because you just step in that quicksand and it's just emulsified sand and you start sinking. And the suction is so bad that you can't get out. The suction, and the more you work, the more you go down. So it said if you had a pole, what you're supposed to do is when you start sinking, to throw the pole down in front of you and then scoot around on your back and put it under your back, okay? And then slowly, after a while, work up your feet and then try to edge yourself towards firm ground. Okay. I don't know. Just in case some of you are walking by the river, pick up a stick, a long one. Okay. A strong one. That's the way you can be saved, I guess, from a quicksand of this world. But what can you do to be saved from the quicksand of sin? There's only one way that you can be saved. There's only one Savior of this world. There is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And that's Jesus Christ. And I like what the writer of The Solid Rock said. The Solid Rock, he said, "My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand." Right? That is the gospel. We do not apologize for preaching the gospel. We do not apologize for preaching God's word here. And when we preach it with zeal, and when we share it with zeal and with joy and with love to help them, listen, God's going to work through that. When you do that with your friends and family, they may not want to hear it at first, but they can be saved. And if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you can do that here this morning. We're going to wrap up. In fact, let me go over all 10. Can you do that? I want you to tell you, Brian is so good. The things that we should be zealous about. You should be zealous about your relationship with God, your love for others, prayer. Keep on. God's honor. Trusting God with your life. I'm just trying to summarize. The spiritual progress of God's people. The salvation of others. Your spiritual ardor. Good works. And finally, the Word of God. Okay, that's just a quick review, right? Anyway, we're going to have a Mother's Day sermon next week on Mother's Day, and I hope you come back for that. But anyway, as I wrap up, I just want to know, if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, you're here this morning, I want to give you an opportunity to respond. If you're on social media, and I'm just praying, aren't you, church, that some people will be listening to this and they'll give their hearts and lives to the Lord Jesus Christ. If you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and you feel the Lord drawing you, you're here this morning, you feel the Lord drawing you to Himself, I pray that you would receive Him. And it's so easy, yet in some ways it's so hard because but it's so wonderful. You just have to let go and just jump into the arms of Jesus. And if you don't know Him, I want you to say this from the bottom of your heart, and I don't want you to be scared, but I want you to know that Jesus died on the cross for you. He loves you, and your life will be transformed by knowing Him. And He has a glorious future for you in heaven. And the Bible says that the angels rejoice in heaven over just one sinner that comes to repentance. So you just say this simple prayer with me this morning. If you're here or watching on social media, just say, "Dear Lord Jesus, please come into my heart and forgive me of my sins. I now trust You as my Lord and Savior. Help me to be all that You want me to be, a true disciple. Help me to grow in You daily. And thank You for loving me so much that You died on the cross for me and prepared a home in heaven for me where I'll be with You forever and ever. And I pray this in Your name, Jesus. Amen." If you prayed that simple prayer and really meant it, you are a born-again child of God. And I want you to read your Bible, find a church you can go to, start praying, fellowshipping with other Christians to do that. If you're here this morning and you have a prayer request, or you want to know the Lord as your Savior, you come forward as we sing our invitation. Would you please rise? Would you please rise? If God's speaking to you, you come this morning. You step out. Don't be embarrassed. You come. You come.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock. rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Agree with that? Would you say amen? Amen. I'm glad that you're on the solid rock of Jesus Christ this morning. Woo! Hallelujah. What do we have? Anything that we need?
Just that faith is going to be standing at the back of the auditorium for those of you that are willing to take that quiz and just see how you do.
Okay.
And thanks for the kind present. Sadie turned 2 years old yesterday.
She was
pretty pooped out today, so that's why she's not here, because she had a little too much fun and a little bit too much cake yesterday. I'll just say that. But anyways, a lot of you guys sent cards, sent messages. Just thanks for blessing her and for being her church family. So yeah.
He has two really cute girls. Oh, they're so cute. My wife sometimes watches Sadie Ray in the nursery. She just tells me all the cutest things she says and does. All right. 5 o'clock tonight, our last David Jeremiah message of this series. Next week, Mother's Day, no evening service, but the lady's going to get a rose. It's going to be a good Sunday next Sunday. So God bless you. Have a great day in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Talk about it. I like it.